I felt we were at war. There was a war to be won. And I think there's no room for part-timers. It was all or nothing.
I can only think it was, you know, the working class escape, you know, if you can't be a footballer, you're, you know, trying to be a musician, that kind of thing. Some way of getting off the, you know, out of the 9-to-5, learn an instrument, form a band, have some fun, write songs. I don't think it was an ideology, just try and be like your heroes.
Where we come from, there's nothing. There's nothing in East London. If you weren't in the gangs or you couldn't play football, boxing, you've got music. I don't think any of us, even in our wildest dreams, thought it would ever become the way it was. You know what I mean? We were just all happy to play.
It helped hard rock, heavy rock, heavy metal. It just gave it an extra boost at a time when it had been pretty much dormant and pretty much ignored.
New wave of British heavy metal was heavy metal's own punk in a way. It's creative. It's not just a marketing ploy. It's a boom time. People in bands, the ones that really are worthwhile talking about, they feed off of that. And that's why you have these kind of, these periods in time where it just goes boom.
At the tail end of the 1960s, popular music began to get louder, along with tracks like the Beatles' Helter Skelter and the Stones' Jumping Jack Flash, which pumped up the volume and the distortion of the rhythm guitars. Fresh acts were appearing who focused on this new, heavier sound. Guitar gods such as Hendrix and Clapton pushed their instruments to the forefront, showcasing their virtuoso ability whilst moving further away from the dominant sounds of pop. It was after the emergence of the new hard rock bands Deep Purple, Led Zeppelin, and in particular Black Sabbath, however, that a new phrase began to circulate, heavy metal. And although this would slowly seep into the common musical vocabulary, where it emerged from and what exactly it defines remains to this day enigmatic.
The first use of the term heavy metal, the whole thing is sort of shrouded in myth, and no one's got a definitive answer. I mean, I've read music texts that sort of describe the Birds even as being sort of heavy metal, which, I mean, sounds absolutely preposterous. Steppenwolf had heavy metal thunder in the lyrics to Born to be Wild, which, I mean, that is so obviously a sort of a reference to sort of an automotive reference rather than a sonic reference, but it's still a reference.
I like smoking lightning. Heavy metal thunder, racing with the wind, and the feeling that I'm under.
I kind of like that. No one ever knows where it came from, sort of thing.
When I first heard the phrase heavy metal, I kind of liked it. I guess I was a bit unsure as to what it meant. I kind of figured that, well, maybe it's like high energy rock. A heaviness that Black Sabbath were so very successful in developing as a unique aspect of their sound and what they did. And others, of course, got heavier and followed suit. But at the time, with no one ever hearing it before, I had no way of knowing what actually they meant by that.
Well, Black Sabbath are kind of looked down as, I mean, these days, as sort of like, you know, the first band. They weren't. They weren't at all. They were just part of a huge group. But, I mean, I think with the name and just the way sort of history has treated them, they become the archetype, as it were. And, you know, if you want to look around for something to sort of pinpoint heavy metal, Sabbath are not just as good. They're probably better than most. But there are a lot of other bands around doing the same sort of thing that don't get mentioned, like a Salor Baltimore are a perfect example, a Leafhound. You can't underestimate the impact of Led Zeppelin and probably even more so than Black Sabbath. Even though, you know, Robert Plant is quite vociferous in his sort of rebuttal of the term. Creative period of music on the tail end of that enormous boom that was inspired by the likes of Sgt. Pepper and Pet Sounds albums that sort of broke the mold. Suddenly people realized they could do whatever they want, and the music industry was set up thus that it allowed them to. And that's where you get, you know, basically heavy metal came from.
And throughout the first half of the decade, Zeppelin, Sabbath and Deep Purple went from strength to strength in a musically diverse climate that saw their heavy rock coexisting with both the extravagance of glam and the excesses of prog. By 1975, however, things were changing, with all these bands broadening their sound and incorporating new elements into their music.
I think by 75, the likes of Zeppelin, Sabbath, Purple had been doing it all a long time. There was a lot of touring going on. There was a lot more emphasis directly from America, as opposed to bringing in sort of 30s, 40s blues. And I think people being heavily influenced by what was going on around them. Purple certainly were spending a lot more time in America, bringing in the likes of Glenn Hughes, who was big on the funk sound and big on Stevie Wonder, was bound to influence them.
Most bands, 5-6 years down the line, have got very little to do with what they were when they started. The mid-70s was a brilliant boom time for funk music. Earth, Wind & Fire, Mother's Finest, the early Commodores. Stevie Wonder, the best music Stevie Wonder ever made, was in that period. Let us start to fall. You don't think that's going to have an effect on people who are at the top of their game musically? They're listening to this stuff and they think, oh, you know, a lot of hard rock fans, sort of with a more sort of narrow-minded approach, are kind of like, oh, no, no, can't have that. Richard Blackmore didn't like it, you know, and he was the essence of Deep Purple, but he quit.
Blackmore, who had been a founding member of Deep Purple, formed a new group, Rainbow, that distanced itself from this new experimentation and returned to a heavy rock sound. Other bands, too, were beginning to emerge that would also keep the hard rock flag flying, including Judas Priest, UFO, Thin Lizzy, Motorhead, and the Australian outfit AC/DC. Yet despite the fact that all these bands were collected in one genre, there was a striking variety in their musical approach.
Thin Lizzy didn't sound anything like UFO. You know, possibly the two biggest sort of heavy rock bands that the UK came up with or the British Isles came up with, you know, in the mid-70s. Thin Lizzy, Celtic folk music and loud guitar music. That's kind of where that one came from. UFO, Deep Purple, and a sort of an even more melodic ear. That's kind of where they sort of come from. Motorhead, well, I mean, Lemmy's on record is saying all he wanted was a UK version of the MC5. And let's face it, if you're actually really stripped down everything Motorhead have ever done, it's not heavy metal, and Lemmy hates the term heavy metal, it's just rock and roll, played very fast and very loud. That's all it is, you know. So it's just, again, it's a myriad of influences and different bits sort of influencing different bands. None of those bands that I've just mentioned sound like each other, and yet they're all lumped in under a banner of heavy metal.
And although each of these hard rock bands would chart their own course throughout the 1970s, it was over the following 5 years in Britain that the first identifiable group of bands appeared who were prepared to fully embrace the term heavy metal and who would constitute a major musical movement. Leighton, East London, a working-class suburb far removed from the glamour of rock and roll. It was here in late 1975 that a young band emerged who would eventually spearhead this new wave of heavy metal. Formed by bassist Steve Harris, Iron Maiden were a driven and ambitious young band, determined to make their mark.
Steve used to come to my house and rehearse, and it was quite self-evident that he had, the boy had direction. You know, he knew exactly where he was going to go. I don't think he probably knew the size that they are now, but he had that focused ideology of what Iron Maiden was about and what the music should sound like and who they were. And to the point that he used to come to my house and we'd go through the bass and drum parts and all that kind of thing to get everything right. And I mean, at that time, the band didn't actually particularly mean anything. It was just another band that was trying to push the frontiers a little bit.
Maiden were not alone. A new bands intent on injecting a new heaviness into hard rock were emerging across the country. In 1976, Son of a Bitch, the band who would become Saxon, formed in Barnsley, and in Stourbridge in the Midlands, school friends Brian Tatler and Duncan Scott formed Diamond Head.
We didn't have any gigs or anything, so we just thought, write songs, practice, you know, in the bedroom, and just see how it goes from there. And eventually we got a bass player and started doing gigs. But initially, I think we're more interested in writing. I don't know why exactly. But I'm glad we did, because we learned our craft, you know. But just recording straight onto cassette and listening back and thinking, that's not right. Analysing the arrangements, really. And we did, you know, a lot of that. We went to see Led Zeppelin, three out of the four members of the band, and we all, you know, sat in this, you know, 100,000 people watching Led Zeppelin. And you know, you probably think, oh, it'd be great to be Led Zeppelin, wouldn't it? You know, it'd be great to be this big, wouldn't it? As we'll go back and play the Crispin in Stourbridge and dream about being as big as Led Zeppelin.
Yet while these new heavy metal bands were honing their craft, there would be a seismic cultural shift in the world of music, a mid-70s revolution that would briefly put other genres out of favour. Punk rock exploded and captured the attention of the public in an unprecedented manner, a situation that would not be to everyone's liking.
My generation had enjoyed the 60s. Then we enjoyed the late 60s into the early 70s when we had this sort of progressive rock stuff around and the blues side, rock and roll side covered. And then things suddenly seemed to drop off, dissipate. What we came up against was this thing called punk, you see, which was, to me, in my way of feeling, like a sort of an anti-human passion.
Completely bemused by it, actually, to be honest with you. You know, while Babylon was burning, the Sounds office was literally a stone's throw from the Roxy Club, you know, where the Clash and the Pistols would play on a regular basis. I mean, I was just sitting in my little corner listening to Ted Nugent and Kiss and Aerosmith, you know. I was kind of a bit of, I suppose, in retrospect, a bit of a pariah.
I couldn't understand the reason for devaluing music. That is, to me, what it was. It was a devaluation in cause of a fashion. That's, to me, what it was. And it was like a shock fashion as well. You know, the more you curse on radio and television when you do get interviewed, the better it is for you. But actually, that's usurping the media for me. I think music is the thing that mattered. And I think excellence within the field is to me what it's all about. I don't believe that you have the right to stand on stage unless you can play right and sing to the nth degree.